Hi all. We're gonna show you how we took DOOP and build it upon it, extended it, create APIs, make it embeddable, make it reusable, and all these nice things. It all started with Jan's question, as it is the case in the group. Can we offer DOOP as a service? The first thing I asked was, what is DOOP? And what service? So to answer the question, we need to reverse the viewpoint we had up to now regarding DOOP. Instead of approaching it from the inside out, now we're going to see it from the outside looking in. At a high level, DOOP comprises a sequence of phases, where each phase is you provide some input options and some parameters. DOOP processes them, performs the post-processing logic, the pre-processing logic, in order to, as we've seen in the presentations, provide a meaning for merge static, record, if you recall from the previous presentations, process adjust with suit to generate the input facts, feed those facts into the logic blocks database, run the data log rules to get the fixed point and the result of the analysis, and print the statistics of what went on with the analysis results. Okay, is that clear? You see that there is in this presentation there are some naming issues. We haven't come up with the official names yet for various things, so we use various identifiers to reflect various things. And so the previous version of DOOP, not the core of DOOP, when I speak about DOOP in this presentation, we are talking about the wrapper around DOOP. We are not talking about the data log magic, okay? We are talking about how to make the data log magic run. Okay, so the previous generation of DOOP, the DOOP legacy, however we used to call it, implemented the phases of we saw before using a combination of Unix commands, Bash scripts, Python scripts, Java commands, depending on what it wanted to do and what tool was available and what was more convenient. And of course, blocks batch commands, which we cannot avoid. Not that we want to avoid, but that's the standard way to communicate with the logic blocks database. This presentation consists of two parts. We'll see the next generation of DOOP, and then we'll see the services integration built upon the next generation of DOOP. And there's a fancy demo there, and that's a nice way to end a 5-day seminar, I think. So, in the new way to invoke DOOP, let's call it this way, the next gen, it's not that we do not use a combination of scripts and things, because there are various dependencies we cannot ignore, and they may be limited. They may limit us, but we have employed a full JVM stack for running all the thing. And although it is a JVM stack, there is no Java there. Java the language, I mean, because Java the platform and Java virtual machine is there. The whole build process, and we'll see some things about it, is based on Gradle. Have we heard of Gradle before? You're going to hear some things today. And on Groovy. Have you heard of Groovy before? We'll get to that. That's a little superfluous slide on purpose. We wanted to employ state-of-the-art technologies, tools, patterns, and practices, offer, let's say it the other way. Since DUP is one of the best static analysis tools, we need to provide one of the best technology stacks to run it upon. So I think this is state-of-the-art cutting edge. And the goal is to take data log and reuse it, the rules and the whole magic that DUP analysis offers, and reuse it in all possible contexts. Okay, that's why it's superfluous. embed it in an application, use it on the server side, make it a client-side application to invoke, start, stop analysis, whatever. Okay. It may sound a little bit open-ended, but we have reached to sort of an ending. So at a glance, we have Gradle, Groovy, and the JVM. So Groovy is an Apache project now. It was the second language targeting the JVM back in 2004, I think, or something. It was developed by the dynamic language community because those guys couldn't start the static and boilerplate features of Java. It has some history behind it, and I'm not going to spend some time there, but practically Groovy is a superset of Java. That's why they call it. I think it's the language that has the best integration on the bytecode level with plain old Java. And it is Java without the boilerplate plus optional typing, dynamic typing, and static typing. It's up to you to decide. A flexible meta-object protocol, functional constructs, closures specifically, and much, much more that I'm not going to cover and stop knocking on the wood. Yes?
What's the boilerplate?
What's the boilerplate? Let's see. The best example. The most common data structure is a list, of course. In Java, you have to, let's say, an array list, or make it a little bit more polymorphic. List L, JSON, okay, new, let's say, array list. Right? Yeah. Jörg was talking yesterday about initial values in a list. Why can I have a constant expression that contains five, my initial values in the list are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I think that's rather trivial to support it. Java doesn't support it. Well, you have to, in the syntax, That's why I mean boilerplate, because the syntax makes you do artificial, not, how to call it. There's not enough sugar to make you feel more, to express what you want without messing with all the Java stuff. So you have to say L, add one, L, add two, L, add three.
Arrays, stored as list, and you provide the var args.
Okay, you can do various things, but that's not supported by the syntax inherently. You have to use some other way to make it, okay? One example of boilerplate, there are plenty. I'm gonna give it perhaps 5 minutes to take a look at what Groovy does, and I hope you can forgive me after that. It's a feature-rich Java-friendly dynamic language for the Java platform. Okay. What is a dynamic language? practically, to code it up, it's a language that permits the type of a variable to be changed at runtime. I declare something and has a value based on the assignment I have at time t1 during execution, and then at time 2 I assign a different value, which perhaps may be of a different type. So the type of the variable is not coupled with a variable as it happens during compilation with the static languages. Okay. There are other things that make it dynamic, but that's the main point. Okay. Okay, this is an example that we inject new functionality in the string class. And all of us, suppose we are pretty familiar with Java, to know that the string class is final. So this seems rather obscure, rather I don't know how to call it. But using the magical things Groovy provides, we shall discuss about it, I can have a string and call a method which didn't exist before, but now it exists, and return true, return false. Okay. That's true. That's not, that doesn't have to do with a type, with a type system. It has to do with the fact that it has a meta-object protocol. Okay?
It's a bit like implicit in Scala.
Perhaps. I'm not neither a C guy nor a Scala guy, so perhaps. That's more, how to call it? These guys are not trying to come up with a holy type system. Like, I think that Scala guys trying to. So that's the what? That's the Java way to get things. So the thing here is that we need to open up our mind a bit, forget a little bit. It's fine that we have the goal of all this is to have static analysis of programs, and we don't use anymore a static language to perform it, and we use a declarative language to. So what we are trying, we need to analyze in static imperative Java code, and we use dynamic declarative code to do it, and dynamic Java code to invoke it. So that's a little bit fun.
That's, I think, the project open to everyone.
Yes, it's polyglot, it's all the principles. Yes. Okay, let's go to something. Let's see optional typing here. I use the keyword def if I'm not interested in the type of the variable that I declare. That tells the Groovy runtime and the Groovy compiler that this is a dynamic variable. Don't care about what the type of this variable is going to be. Okay, and I assign it a string. Okay, I have an assertion that shows that the actual type of this variable is a string. And then I assign it an int. And then the type of the variable changes. Okay, that's what dynamic typing is all about. The thing in Groovy is that you can decide which variables will be dynamic and which variables will be static. So if I specifically declare a variable using a type, not a def, but this is an integer, I cannot assign it a non-integer value. That's what optional typing is all about. Okay? Okay. Lipon, okay, we have various tools with the language. First of all, there's a compiler that reads Groovy sources and generates Java bytecode. A Groovy cell, a Groovy console, a UI tool to run and execute Groovy, the Groovy interpreter, and the Groovy doc, similar to Java doc. That's the Groovy console. And that's how hard it is to define a list with some values. There are such tiny details that all gather up and make the code far, far more readable. That's the actual benefit of using a language like Groovy. Yes?
So the list there is a list of integers or a list of don't care what?
In Java, what is it?
OK. In Java, it's a list of integers.
No. 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 Generics are not verified. No. It's a list of objects. Yes?
The same question. Okay, but in the back end, yes, but here, what would the programmer write if they wanted to say that list is a type? Can they say just list or
no,
list?
No, no, Java generics are there.
Ah,
yeah.
Generics are there.
But I think the.
Groovy is a superset. You can write everything you could in Java.
Java is compiled. You can feed the Groovy compiler with any valid Java code and it will provide a .dot class file. So Java to Groovy is straightforward. And in almost all cases, Groovy to Java is also, I mean, to invoke and link Groovy code. Not in all, but in most cases. Java generics are, I will not characterize it, not a great feature of Java, let's call it this way. Okay. So whatever the Java runtime does with generics, it's what? It's Java bytecode underneath, okay?
You said not a great feature or a great feature?
No.
Not a great feature.
Okay.
George?
So is the... so is everything that is compiled to bytecode, is it truly legal Java code? So is the Groovy compiler as aggressive in its type checking, for instance, as the
no,
Java
you guide the compiler to be as aggressive as you want it to be. It's not aggressive
can
by
you
default.
Guide it to be as aggressive as the Java.
You
compiler?
Can tell it to be aggressive, but it won't be that aggressive like the Java C, no matter what. Practically, if you see a Java, if you see bytecode, if you see a class file. There are various. The whole thing with Groovy, it has call sites, or first class objects. And then these call sites invoke the meta object of the actual, the meta class to resolve where it goes. It's a little bit complicated. You lose it. You cannot have it back what the initial code intended to do. Okay. And it's a dynamic language, so you can't force the compiler to be aggressively static. It can be a little static. Yeah.
But you don't care very much because you don't write a lot of code in Groovy, right?
Yes.
You write the framework
yes,
around
yes.
the loop, which is thin.
No. You can write as much code as you like. Then.
No, I mean, you don't really want, this came from shell scripts. You took shell scripts and you rewrote them as Groovy code, more elegant, more...
No.
This
no.
Yeah.
No.
Groovy didn't came from
no.
shell scripts.
No.
Okay.
No.
So what was in its place that got replaced by Groovy? Nothing. You...
Bash scripts.
Ah,
and
bash
some
scripts.
Python
scripts. Yeah.
Yes, that's it. But that's not the point here. I'm not... trying to show you how we took a bash script and we turned it into a Groovy something.
The question is why Groovy? You know, why not Python, Ruby, whatever, or
because
why not Java?
You already have Java.
But you already have Java, so you want something Java based.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
And Groovy is a nice language and it's very powerful.
Yes.
And you're not going to miss that last optimization due to dynamic typing because you know you don't write a million lines of code with Groovy.
No, you can write a million, a billion lines of code with Groovy. It depends on what the application does. Premature optimization is the root of all evil, okay? We don't care about optimization. We don't. At this point, and then what we are trying to do, we don't care about optimization. You have data log rules that take some time to execute. If I spend a second or two doing some, it doesn't make any, doesn't offer any benefit, it doesn't add any value. So. We don't care about performance.
You want a friendly language, right? You want like
a highly expressive dynamic language. Yeah. To if it weren't for the dynamic thing, we couldn't replace bus. There is some reason why bus is used by, it's easy to do the things that you need to do, more or less, with its peculiarities and idiosyncrasies, but it is. But Groovy takes that all away, and you have the JVM power. Should we need to connect to a database to perform a query, it's one line away. Do that with bus. No, you have the power of the whole Java stack. That's the reason. And we don't need to write Java in the old way, public class, you know, and take a sleep. Okay, we need to write what we need to write.
Is it also because it integrates well with Gradle, which is the build system?
That's the reason why they are together. That's the second reason.
But you can have Gradle without using Groovy.
And you can have Groovy without Gradle.
Uses Gradle and the code is in Java.
It's not since to the Groovy decision was more important than the Gradle one. Initially, you can have them separately, though.
So basically, you don't like Java. So
no, I like Java. I like Java. I like Java. I think that, of course, I like Java. That's why. The answer is which Java do you mean? Java the language? No, it's getting too old, I think, and it's backwards compatible with, I don't know what. Okay. Microsoft, for example, decided that its version of the yes, of the C# would break the backward compatibility with the previous one. That came with a reason. There would be no link queue, for example, without that. So I think that the failure of generics, because it's a big design failure, all this thing, it's a lie, the Java generics things. Okay, in my opinion, because all the type information, all the generics are lost at runtime. So we are practically trying to, how to call it, to disguise or to treat the developer as though he doesn't understand. No, that's wrong. That's my opinion. So as a dynamic language, you can invoke the interpreter, the classical plus E, minus E call to evaluate, and then provide Java code there. Or you can, for example, list your files recursively. If you don't know LS, you can use this. So another thing about boilerplate is that you can open a file, name it dot something dot groovy, and start writing the code. There is no public class, there is no imports, there's nothing. So this is a function, calculates the Fibonacci numbers, and this is the code that accepts the arguments and print lines and print outs the. There is no main method, there is no class declaration. These are automatically generated by the compiler, by the runtime. During invocation, it compiles it on the fly, it makes all the necessary declarations for you and feeds it up to the JVM to run it. So we run the interpreter using this file with this input, and it prints out the output. Okay, then we can take this .groovy file, compile it with Groovy C, and the only requirement to run it is to provide the Groovy runtime at the class path. Is that clear? This will generate a Fibonacci.class. And since it doesn't have any class declaration, Groovy will use it as a main, as an entry point, and will generate all the boilerplate for you. Okay, most of the syntax is identical. There are some default imports that permit you to write directly what you want to do. Okay, these are a little bit details. Okay, I think you have an idea. I hope. Everything is an object. There are no primitives. All arithmetic is big decimal arithmetic. So you don't have to do with precision and things like that. What else? Yes, operator overloading is there. And all the various, a million details that makes you write, what you want to write, a little bit more easy to perform and more expressive and more powerful, in my humble opinion. So, two things. Last things about Groovy. Classes, how, what, the way you should, I think the way you should look at Groovy is what defaults or what kind of magic does it do? What Java required you to write, for example, setters and getters. That's another, the whole Java beans thing. It's another, it's not an issue of the language, but again, you have to treat the developer like he's retarded and has to manually by hand get surname, set surname, get full name, set full name. That's the holy grail of. So, all things in Groovy are public by default. So, it's public if you don't offer a modifier. So, it's a class person that has two fields, and we override the toString method. And here are some things that are not very nice with Groovy. There are no return statements required. The last evaluated expression is the return value. And there are string interpolation.
Well, it's the same with lambdas, right?
Yeah, that's what they tried to. No, lambdas in Java are like Groovy. Groovy is older. And this is the generates by default all the getters, all the setters. Okay, it's a super absolutely normal Java class to use. I compile the person, I have a person class. Okay. If I want to use it from Groovy, Groovy has a nice feature. In most of the cases, it is a nice feature. One other thing with the Java boilerplate we talked before is constructor overloading. Okay, constructor overloaded made you write all the possible entry points to this class, combined all together. Okay. If you don't define a constructor in a Groovy class, Groovy will generate the default one, which is this. A map. Practically, this is syntactic sugar to pass a map. The key, the value, the key, the value. And the Groovy injects at compile time the code to try to find these names in your fields in the class and assign them the values you provided here. Is it clear? So there, practically there is no reason to spend any more time into constructors and how they one invokes the other and this and super and all these things. Okay. In most of the cases, this makes there will be cases that this won't be sufficient, and you'll have to get back to the old Java way to write constructors. But there is one out of 10 that you should deal with it. Nine times out of 10, this is sufficient. And this is a Java code that uses the compiled version, the dot class, the person class, compiled with Groovy. I define a new person. I set it a surname. I have explicitly never defined a set surname method, but it is automatically generated. I set the name, or I can define a map, put the values I want there, and invoke the map constructor. That's not magic. It's actually a map constructor there. So if you define a map and you feed it to the constructor, you will instantiate the object as expected, hopefully. Because remember, there is dynamic typing here, so you can have it declare the string and feed it with an integer, and I don't know what would happen. There are some cases, some corner cases like that, which you keep them in mind and be cautious at what you write. That's all.
How does the bytecode appear when you invoke a method with named parameters? Is it like it's creating a map in
yes.
the background?
Yes. This is ordinary Java code. It has nothing to do. And the bytecode, the signatures of the method, are there. It's valid Java bytecode. It's the compiler that injects code in there to make it more comfortable to write things like that. That's the first thing. And the second one, that's always impressive to discuss it. That's a nice switch. I can have a string, I can have a range, I can have a date, I can have a regular expression, I can have a specific items in a list, I can have custom code to run, and I have a default. Okay. The if here is.
They have the break here.
Sorry?
The break here.
Yeah. Closures. That's the second thing. And the things we saw about with constructors and how objects are easily decorated with necessary methods. And this, we're going to discuss about closures, is all we need to know about Groovy to make it, to understand what Gradle does behind the scenes, as we'll see next. Closure is an anonymous function and may accept parameters, return a value, can be assigned to variables, it's a first class citizen of the type system, can be passed as arguments to other functions, okay, like any functional language, and captures the variable of the surrounding lexical scope. Okay. Think of it as a Groovy way to write anonymous inner classes. It's the same thing without the boilerplate, again. Sort of, but that's a good way to start. So, this seems a lot like a method declaration, but it's the equals that shows that we have an expression here that is evaluated to something that is assigned to this variable. So this something, there are always curly braces to indicate the start and ending of a closure, and we have a head and a body. The head defines the variables, the parameters, the arrow, and then it's a body. Okay, a lot like lambdas. What type is that? That's a closure. If you don't define parameters in your closure, there will be by default an IT variable inside it. So that's a little bit more readable, which is not always what you want, but you get used to it. That's a little bit a design decision, but sometimes it makes things easier, but I'm not sure it always
something
pays off.
Stretching yesterday, if you have a closure,
yes.
And inside you have another closure,
yes.
Can the inner close refer to the it from the outer closure, or you have to name the variables?
That's a little bit tricky there. I think you have to somehow qualify it, I think.
But in what way? Because it's not like the closures, the anonymous class that you have.
Declare a variable and assign it to it. That's the easiest way to. So we can do all the functional magical things with closures. Like caring or function composition. Okay, I'm not gonna go into the details, but all the magic is there. Okay, so the final thing about Groovy. I have a method. It doesn't matter what it returns. Void. Do it, and it accepts, I don't know, a string. Let's let's say a closure. Okay, that's a signature. There is this brilliant, I think, trick, this brilliant syntactic sugar, let's call it, that permits you to invoke this method like that. Do it. And then the closure, whatever the closure code you want to, you don't need to instantiate by hand the closure object, pass it as a parameter. This is a nice way in the Groovy syntax to have closures always as the last argument and use this way to provide the code of the closure, right in there where you declare it. Okay, here is, I don't know, takes int psi and so does something to psi. Okay, is this clear? Because all the magical Groovy things are filled with this pattern.
No, hold on. This is a closure inside the curly braces. It's yes. It's going to need to declare an argument.
Not necessarily. Just an example here.
It's a closure with an empty environment. Doesn't bind any outer variables.
No, you could bind if you want.
Yeah,
in this specific incarnation, no, it doesn't bind to anything. Yes. Practically, this is, let's call it, a functor, a function, which is the Java 8 lambdas. View it something like that.
Okay, so if do it, the definition of do it, let's say, expects the closure to accept two arguments.
It will fail at random.
Now it accepts one there, right?
There is a code that invokes do it, passing.
Yes. I understand.
It will fail at random. If there is code that expects two arguments inside do it, that's a definition of do it. Perhaps do it could do something with a string and then invoke closure as a callback, which is another very usual example in dynamic things and in JavaScript words and all these things. Do this asynchronous operation and then invoke the callback.
But I don't understand the syntactic sugar. Isn't that just carrying? You take something that you have a function, a higher order function that takes two arguments, you give it one, it returns you a value that's a function that accepts one argument,
no,
and then you give it the other one.
No. That's ordinary Java method invocation.
No, so yeah. I suppose you cannot just call do it with just one argument, right?
No.
You cannot have this thing.
No, you can if you declare do it with the default parameter.
But
it's even worse than carrying.
Yannis, I think the thing that's misguiding you there is that you can drop the parentheses.
These parentheses?
Can you not?
Yes, of course, but that.
So there you invoke do it with two arguments, x.
The comma. It's just a convenient way in the syntax. It just makes the things that you want to do more readable. But this is a method declaration, okay? And this is a method invocation.
So the thing that this syntax makes better is that it eliminates the closing parentheses from the bottom.
No. Forget the parentheses. Forget the parentheses. That's it. Forget the parentheses. We'll discuss all things together. I have a method declaration that accepts number of parameters, and the last parameter is a closure. Okay. You can. That's the way to invoke it.
Yeah, that's the last
parameter. The compiler here knows how to take the code of the closure, generate the closure object. All closures are callables in Java. Of course, they have a call method. Okay. But you can do this to make it a little bit more readable so that you don't have to close the parentheses and I have to do this and take that and take this code as an extra step. Okay? And what George K. said, we have, may I have a do it with string and foo. Okay, I can invoke it. Let's foo, lowercase b, a foo variable. The parentheses are optional. That's it. As a second.
The replacement sometimes is optional.
The placement is optional, and there are cases where they are mandatory, because if you do, for example, what we see with a factorial, if I don't provide parentheses, Groovy will try to look for a property, for a field, not a method, in whatever context we are there. Okay, so we have, when there are no arguments, you have to provide the parentheses.
Is there an international obfuscated Groovy conference where we can submit entries?
Of course,
Groovy conference. Does it have any kind of macros?
No. There's no pre-processing, no things like that. No. Can you open the build grail? So, let's see it. Now that we have seen these peculiar things.
Costas, just a second.
Yes.
If anyone is interested in looking at Groovy examples, you have the Dubrevo, so you can search under source.
We shall see class or two.
You would skip the.
This seems very strange at first, and the reaction of you is more or less expected. But okay, we've seen some of the major features required to get Groovy starting growing in us. Okay, if it will survive or not, I'm not sure. But this is the main build file of the dupe next gen. This is the Gradle file that runs all the magical things and make them compile and make the pre-processing things and all the magic. So I apply some plugins. Now with a little bit Groovy experts, what is this? Practically there is an apply method somewhere, and this is a map as an argument. Here we define a task with this name, a map as the first argument, and then a closure that customizes the task. Okay.
What's the concept of the task?
We need to be in the Gradle. I have skipped some slides to make this. Okay. Back to the.
No.
Can you?
No.
To the presentation. Not this one?
We're done with Groovy.
Yeah, we're done with Groovy, but I need to introduce a little bit of Gradle. Okay? Groovy is a build automation and build integration tool. You can invoke ANT from Gradle very easily, for example. It is a replacement for Make, ANT, Maven, Ivy, custom script, whatever. Mainly it is for JVM ecosystem, but there's been some activity with native C, C++ in the near past, so they're trying to make it a great build thing for the universe thing, whatever. Very, very small introduction about Gradle. It's basic features that you build by convention. There are some meaningful defaults that you don't spend time configuring.
Like Maven, right?
Well, there's no XML there, so. Mostly your builds are declarative, as we shall see, because you have a closure at the end that customizes the thing that you have declared before. And you can write custom code if you want to be imperative, but when all the plugins are in place, you just declare what you want to happen, not how it will happen. It's a Groovy-based DSL with a deep API. Supports multi-project builds. I can have multiple source code projects and create a Grady project that compiles them all together into one. It provides automation and downloading of dependencies and resolving and all these nice things that Maven and I've introduced. And it has the concept of plugins. If you want to, there's a standard way to compile, let's say, Java code. You apply the Java plugin and it provides the default conversions that most people use, the default source for locations to find the source files and things like that. So, the major concepts of Grail. There is a build script, okay, which is a build configuration script for your build process. What are the parts of the build, how it is configured, how these interact, which are the dependencies among them. There is the notion of a project. All these objects are practically exposed through the DSL to your build script. So the task, it will be a Java class org.gradle.whatever.task that exposes a set of methods that you can use in your build script. But they are all glued through Groovy-based DSL with the various automation and assumptions that I showed you with the closures and the maps. Task is an atomic step of your build. An internal dependency is a task depending on another task or a project depending on another project, something that lives inside Gradle. The external dependency is that my code, in order to compile, requires Apache Commons file utils or whatever. Okay, you declare in the Maven way, you declare your dependencies and Gradle knows how to download them and make them available at compile time. There is a directed acyclic graph to determine which are the dependencies when Gradle is invoked. There are repositories to download dependencies from. There are dependency configurations. I have a configuration for a compile configuration. I have a dependency configuration named compile, which it provides all the jars that my project requires to compile. And Groovy knows how to download it. Gradle knows how to design. There are publications, which are the artifacts produced by the build process. Okay, I build a specific project to generate something. This is maybe a jar, maybe a war, maybe whatever.
Can we use this DSL, which is based on Groovy, to introduce like a number of new tasks based on some template?
Yeah, I've done that yesterday.
Get back to the big Gradle, please. Practically, this is a shortcut for declaring a variable of type task, constructing it for invoking the constructor. And this is the constructor arguments. And this is the code that customizes it. This task has the Gradle version as an attribute. There is a field defined in this class. And we haven't seen that on the Groovy things, and Yannis will start yelling now, but you can at runtime modify the this of the Gradle, of the closure. So this is configured to use task as this variable, as the delegate, as it is called in Groovy literature. Okay, so that's a very nice pattern to have very custom things, very easily, very easily configured and very readable. Respectively, here I define the repositories of the dupe project, where the dupe looks up for dependencies, and this is the Maven Central, which is a method, as you can see here, because it needs a parenthesis. These are the dependency configurations we talked before. I start and declare the dependencies and have a compile, and there are two or three or four various notations to express them. Here is the way, most of the way that the Maven repository expects them to to be expressed. And this here is a custom task. It's not included when I apply these plugins. There are various tasks automatically included in the build file. Here I declare, we declare one of our own, where, as we can see here, description for some reason is a method inside the Java exec task, because there is no equals, there is no assignment. You see? All the others are fields. There is somewhere in the documentation a Java exec task that exposes these properties. So it's very convenient, very easy. If you get all these things, at first you don't get them. It takes some time to. And even if you're not familiar with Groovy, it's not very handy. But so that's great. Okay. Presentation. I'm gonna speed up things. Okay. So let's get back to Doop, because that's the reason why we're here. Can you open IntelliJ and open the analysis option class if you can? Oh yeah, nice. So the major concepts in the new Doop, in Doop Next Gen, is the analysis. The analysis is all the information that parameterized the analysis invocation, all the options and all the arguments the user has provided, along with the logic to execute it. When I say the logic, I'm not talking about the data log logic. I'm talking about the algorithm for doing the phases. Invoke the preprocessor with these arguments and generate the logic files, place them in this directory, and then invoke the suit using these jars as inputs. All this glue encode that requires, that takes the input, the jar of the analysis as an input, and makes it and drives it back to the end to generate the results in the logic blocks DB.
Yes. The difference between the previous Doop and the next gen is that in the previous Bas, Python, and Linux,
no, the logic was
being replaced with a Groovy.
Yes, with two, three class files. Two, three classes. It doesn't matter if it's Groovy or Java. Okay, this is an analysis option, the definition of what are the attributes of an argument provided to Groovy, to Doop. Okay, we use it because there is a lot of experimentation happening. New arguments are introduced that lead up to different pre-processing in the logic or different variables inside the data log files or whatever. So we needed a way to have analysis option is a first class object to make it easy to determine how the various Doop components will use it. It has a description, it has a value, it participates in caching because there is some caching going on. It can be pre-processed or not. It participates in the web UI, we'll see it hopefully. It has a name, it has a command line invocation, where there is a file. There is some metadata regarding an analysis option fed to the to the Doop Next Gen. Okay. And analysis. Okay, and that's an analysis, the code that executes all the phases we saw before. The analysis has an ID, it has a name, it has an output directory, a cache directory, it has a map of options. Don't care about that at the moment. There are some input files that provided, the JRE, just to to be used, the dubjari-lib environment variable practically, the environment in which to execute custom commands, the preprocessor, various things like that. And there is a run method, analysis runables, that performs all the logic, performs all the phases. There are methods to indicate the various phases. Okay. An ordinary Java modeling of what a dupe analysis requires to be invoked and run and all these things. So it's not just a bash script. It's not a rewrite of custom commands. There is some modeling on what dupe tries to do. Okay. Using an object-oriented language and all the machinery provided. Okay. What else? Yes. And there is also another thing. These analysis objects are created through analysis factories. There is the dupe.core.analysisFactory class provides a new analysis with some default with some specific parameters, and there we define a different factory for each different way to create a new analysis. If you see in the source code, in the dupe repo under the source directory, and you navigate to main/groovy, I think, or groovy/main. There is the analysis factory and there is a command line analysis factory. A factory that knows how to process the arguments inside the command line and return an analysis object. Okay, and there are various other factories used elsewhere in dupe, but they are not part of the duplex gen. Okay, so it's just an object-oriented way to take what conceptually a set of phases that do various things, run them, create them using various ways to parameterize them and all these things.
Can we do a listing of the files so we can, I mean, I'm looking at them here, but if you put a listing of the files on the screen and tell us roughly what each one does, so we have some idea of all the functionality.
Yeah. I can give it a try.
Can you? Dupe directory of the source main groovy dupe.
Okay. So everything's going to be. I don't know whether you are able. Oh, yeah.
We can just start it terminal.
Okay. Can you give it a try, please? CDSRC. CDSRC. I think it will be. What? Do you want to try the dupe repo on Bitbucket? Perhaps it will be
no,
a bit more.
It should be fine here.
It's fine here, okay. Did the main groovy?
Okay, so there are dupe under that.
CD dupe, yeah. Core.
And there are some files here. So
yes.
Command line analysis factory, that's a specialization of the analysis factory.
Yes. The custom analysis post processor, but when the analysis is complete, by default, the logic does not invoke anything. You have to provide the post-processor that you want to. This post-processor prints the statistics, for example. Okay, the main.
You clean the background.
Yeah, yeah. Or I can.
Okay. So right now we don't use any of this.
No. Oh, everything
exactly
is
that.
Yes. There is a dupe. You have invoked in this seminar the dupe script. The dupe script invokes Gradle.
Yes.
Dupe and the dupe nectar are the same thing, minus some logic files. They
more or
the
less,
dupe
more
is
or
the
less.
Dupe legacy repo, but you haven't seen that.
That's you've used exactly that, but the difference is that because it's Groovy, this is also what more advanced clients, not just a command line client of Dupe, more advanced clients meaning a server, web clients, etc. That's what they're also using to invoke Dupe as a service.
Have
but that's exactly what you used when we typed ./Dupe, when you run an executable
yeah.
with Dupe. That's what you used without looking at Dupe.
Practically, it is invoked this.
Even the
this class.
The post processor is invoked.
Yes.
Yes.
Okay.
Everything required does a high level step. Let's call it this way. It's not some command that only in Unix can be invoked. Whatever peculiar dependency is expressed in this code.
Besides a few little places where you have we have explicit calls for create a symbolic link, everything can run, for example, in Windows if the engine itself could run in Windows.
Yes, but the engine does not run in Windows, so...
Yeah, but I mean that the script around Dupe is not...
Yeah, we have tried everything so you can run Dupe in all operating systems. As a final display of... can we open the main method? The main Groovy?
But we want to go over these files roughly.
You want to? Ah, okay.
Oh,
yes.
Good.
If we start from the main method, it will be more easy for me to describe what the files do. What the files do.
We really just want to get an idea, like for instance, what is workspace connector, what is helper, what is JRE, what is input resolution context, just some. What's Ivy resolver?
Yeah, I don't think we need to look at Groovy code.
We don't need to look at Groovy code.
Okay.
This is not that complex. It's like, 4,000 lines of code overall. If someone needs to change it, they can inspect it as long as they understand the high-level architecture of what this is trying to do.
Okay. Okay.
Does it also encapsulate suit?
Yes.
No. Suit?
There is a suit fact generation project. Okay. There's some Plast code that invokes suit, parameterized with custom code, the custom logic, and generates the.
So it's not an encapsulation, but an invocation of suit.
But it invokes Java code.
Yeah.
Our suit driver is written in Java. So under Dupe/source, what you see is two parts. You see Groovy and Java. Java is our suit. Fact generator, it's our
another
thing that generates the fact. And Groovy is what calls everything. All the Java, the data log engine.
Give us the command line and stuff.
Yep.
But we use suit through Java, not
Just
through Groovy.
So a benefit of using the JVM stack and Gradle is that the team can now gather all the Java things in one project. And have Gradle run it and do all the magical things. And Groovy, depending on what the task at hand is, knows how to invoke it. For example, suit is not in the old, in the Dupe legacy, you have to invoke a JVM. Java minus this thing, minus the other thing, run suit. Okay. Now, since it is inside the JVM, it just invokes the main method directly, changing the class loader, mimicking how a new JVM has been invoked. there are some little benefits like this that make them all the code available in one repo. You have to, you don't have to split a mini project here, a sub project there, and dependency there. It all starts to gather at one point. So, the dupe core package, the classes of interest are the analysis factory, the analysis option, the analysis processor. This is just an interface with a process method. Okay, this is meant to be invoked after an analysis has completed. This is the a helper class that knows how to initialize dupe. What it means to initialize dupe, to read the environment variables and create the output directory, the log directory. 2-3 directories that need to be created, and is the holder of all the supported analysis options. This is a definition of an analysis option. This is the actual declaration of the option support. Okay. Helper is a helper, various helper methods, and those are tiny little enums or non-important helpers that make no important contributions everywhere, anywhere. So, these are the five main concepts that drive dupe, the execution of the dupe analysis, the phases of the, okay? These are the five classes. In the blocks package, we have a way, the workspace connector here is an interface that defines the interactions between a running dupe analysis and the logic blocks workspace, which are practically wrappers atop of Bloxbats and Bloxbats invocations. Bloxbats minus create minus overwrite, it has a method wrapping this Bloxbats invocation, and things like that. This is a blocks package. The input package. In Dupe Next Gen, we support jar files that can be provided through a file path. Okay, you say minus J and you give the path to the jar file. You can say minus J and provide the URL, and Dupe Next Gen will download this jar. And you also can write a dependency as in Maven. Org.apache. Something, I don't know, Elastic, colon, version 3.0. This will download it through the Maven repository. So the input package and all the classes there try to handle and implement the main concept is the input resolution context. Each analysis invoked is parameterized in the way how the inputs provided are resolved. And that's the input resolution context. So we have a directory resolver, a file resolver, an Ivy resolver. How you have a string, and I have to download the artifacts that refer to this string provided. Command line analysis factory, command line analysis processor, and the main method, the main class, and some various other helpers that are practically wrappers to executing operating system commands. And that's it.
Okay, so dupe primarily, these scripts primarily take a jar file as input to produce the analysis.
Yes.
Can you make it take a Groovy, a Gradle project?
Yes. 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 Is there anything else regarding the Dupe Next Gen? So you can see a quick demo and two more slides. And
you mean we can already analyze the Gradle project, or what's the answer to that question?
When if I get the question correctly, I think that Neville, you're asking whether you can integrate the execution of an analysis with an existing Gradle project. No.
So. Let's say a client comes along with his Java project with the Gradle build files.
I don't think there will be graded build files yet. There will be AND files or MAVE files.
No, there will be graded.
Okay. So that's a nice client.
It's very popular.
That's a nice client.
Okay.
Okay.
Can this integrate with
can you
program?
Can we analyze?
Can you open the example?
Yeah.
I mean, Gradle has been used since 2010, 11. So.
Yeah.
It's currently used by Android in Android Studio instead of Android.
Yeah. So this is.
We cannot see those colors.
Yeah. That's
if it's Emacs.
Can you?
Is it in a window or Emacs?
It's
the shell.
In the shell.
If it's in the shell, you have to change the shell colors, the terminal colors.
Should I go back to the previous one?
Anastasis, why don't you just invoke the Gradle analyze thing and take it from that? Okay. There is a Gradle project here, source code viewer demo, a pet project that has some Java code. It is defined in Gradle, it has uses Gradle as its build file. And we have, can you return to the
Which one? To the
invocation console? Okay. We have just invoked, we're in this project, and we have invoked Gradle through the Gradle wrapper, whatever that means, Gradle invocation. And call the custom analyze task. This is a custom task we have provided the Gradle plugin that does various things, standing on the shoulders of DoubleNextGen, to take the code, compile it, process the source code to generate some scavenge information that Anastasis will discuss about, and post it to the server. Okay.
That one, Centauri.di.
Yes. Yes, all these are configurable, where to post it and what to. So if we get back to Centauri, there's the dupe server running there. The web UI.
Okay.
Yes, that's the web UI of the dupe server. Can we go to the analysis, to the home screen? I'm this user, the dupe plugin. Knows how to connect, you provide the credentials. And this is the analysis, the jar file I have uploaded without running dupe by hand. I'll just run a Gradle task. Okay? Since, as we've seen throughout all this week, dupe operates on the bytecode, Anastasis has provided some magic to take source code into account and gather information about classes, fields, methods, variables, and various other things at the source code level representation in order to make it, to combine it with a bytecode and offer. If we open the view sources.
So here we're looking at two different things. Beyond the dupe project, we're looking at the JDupe server project. We're looking at analysis as a service. So a server that invokes some of the Duke Groovy code and can analyze projects. And that server is running on Centauri, on our physical server machine. And we're looking at something completely different, which is a combination of a compiler, Java C compiler plugin that takes the source code and connects that source code with the results of a Duke analysis.
We can discuss and see what we have, but just to see where we are now with the concept of dupe as a service, the one effort is to integrate it with the build environment of the developer. We have a Gradle plugin that is just with ordinary Gradle, the ordinary Gradle way to apply a plugin and offer a magical analyze task, to connect to the server, post the analysis, the server has run the analysis, it has been finished, and then we have a post-processing step. We've seen the analysis phases of the dupe logic. And then we have a post-process step that takes the source code representation and maps it to the dupe ref modes and the other representations to make the user and offer him what? Please, be my guest.
Okay, so
far points to information. Okay. Yeah. Interactively.
So of course there are also UI components now. There's a code browser, web-based, that uses this information to present the code. So how is your analysis service calling those Groovy files?
Okay.
Like what part of the Groovy files, where is the interfacing?
Can we to go to the PowerPoint?
The what?
To the PowerPoint.
Oh, the PowerPoint, sorry.
Okay. So, what? I have my mouse, right? Okay, this was a short demo, what we have come up with what running Dupe as a service means and what we are trying to accomplish. At. There are many things to be determined. There is plenty of work to be done. So, since Dupe Next Gen, Dupe, is written in JVM language now, can be embedded in any JVM application. Okay. You can create custom applications invoking Dupe and using the classes we've seen. Yeah, you can create, if I include Dupe as a dependency, instantiate in a new analysis factory and provide the appropriate arguments, a new analysis will be created. It won't be run. If I call the run method on the analysis object, the analysis will run. And it will fail because no blowbacks was found and all the various things, the complex things that has to do with actually running the data log rules. But up to the Java code, it's one, two calls away to invoke the execution of an analysis. It's an environment set up to make it actually workable, make the actual invocation work. So that's viewing Dupe as a Java app, as a Java library. We use it to offer the services we have demonstrated in the demo, okay? And practically, there is a web UI, the screens you saw. This is a JavaScript single-page applications with modules and required JS and various fancy things to make it all be very, how to call it, interactive and fast. There is a Dupe API, a RESTful-like API, that provides a means to list the analysis of a user, create a new analysis, start it, stop it, delete it, query it. The analysis is on the server. You use the API and you can perform all those things upon the analysis. And there is also a Groovy API consumer. There is a RESTful API. Are we familiar with that RESTful APIs? No? Just a means to invoke a method through the web, let's call it this. Okay, it is the cutting edge at best way to do it now, but conceptually, a RESTful call is just a remote method invocation call, conceptually. Okay, start an analysis. And I provide the analysis ID. Conceptually, it's exactly the same. So we have a client that can, that knows how to perform these calls and display the results in a command line interface. Okay, and we have the actual value there is the Groovy code that performs the calls, because the client is now a library, and we can include it in another project, and this is what the Gradle plugin does. The Gradle plugin takes the client, okay, because in order to be able to post the analysis to the server, it has to make the call, create a new analysis. And these are its options, and these are the jars. So there are various components that build upon each other, and ultimately they build upon the Dupe Next Gen. And there is the JavaC plugin and the Gradle plugin. JavaC plugin, Anastasis will give us a. And while Anastasis, do you think I'll do a drawing?
So the purpose of the DupeJC plugin is to extract information from the source code of a project, and this information in particular is related to the analysis we perform. So as you have seen, we had var points to relations, call graph ed relations, and instance field or static field points to relations. So we need to find a way to map the symbols in the source code of the project with the actual analysis results. And also what we wanted to do was to extract static information in order to provide ID-like features to our source code browser. And we do this by traversing the AST of a Java program, and also by utilizing the symbol tags produced by the analyze step of the Java C. And the plugin is invoked by build tools like Grail. We demonstrated this here. And we intend to do it for Maven or Ant, and you can even invoke it by the command line interface. One problem is that we can only use the Java compiler plugin with Java version 8. This is the only limitation we have. And the other thing is that we need to compile the full project in order to extract the static type information. Also, we could even produce a subset of the facts generated with the plugin, since we do the mapping between input facts in Dupe and symbols like variables, classes, and stuff like that. We could even do some of the things that Sud does, although we don't do that yet. So currently the symbols we collect are packages, classes, fields, methods, and local variables. These are all taken from the symbol tables, while the method invocations, heap allocations, and variable occurrences are taken by traversing the AST of the project. For most of these symbols, we also try to get their unique dupe names, the ref modes of actually the keys of the tables, like the variable table, the method invocation table, and for example, for a variable named B in the main method of class A, the ref mode would be a.main/B. A problem here is that we can't distinguish, for instance, variables with the same name in the same method, and even now the plugin has several limitations. It doesn't support all Java features yet. But we're working on that, and in order to have more precision, we need to take, for instance, the positions of the variables, I mean the line number, the column number, in order to draw them in the canvas you saw. And we do all this using several visitors. One visitor is to identify the packages, classes, fields, variables, and methods. We have one visitor for the method invocations and heap allocations, and two visitors for the variable occurrences, either uses or defs, and we try to invoke them at the right place of the branches in order to get the information we want. We store all this information in JSON files, which are then uploaded when we post the analysis to the JDuke server, and they are we put them in a database, and after the analysis run, we perform a post-processing step which just joins the results of the analysis with the static information of the plugin. So for instance, you have seen these relationships like var points to instance field points to static field points to and call graphheads. We have all these other relations which are from the plugin, variable heap allocation, field, method invocation, and method. All these relations have keys, and we try to combine the keys from the heap allocations and variables in order to create the var points to relation. We do the same for instance field points to, static field points to, and call graphheads. So in the end we have a completed database, and we can query the result of the analysis. Depending, of course, on the analysis, we could have even more relations for other types of analysis. But right now we are at this stage. And that's pretty much it.
So the whole interdependency between the various dupe projects, we have the DupeNextGen, which contains the logic, the data log rules, and the data log magic, and the Java Groovy, all the gluing code. And then there's Dupe Server that exposes the API and the UI. And it is me. Okay, I don't speak it out loud. I'm not that clever. And Dupe Server. The DupeNextGen is a compile time dependency of Dupe Server. Okay, has to takes DupeNextGen and builds upon it in order to be able to invoke analysis in a multi-tenant manner. Various users can post and run various analyses at the same time and see the results and all these things.
Does that instantiate different databases for every client or user?
It creates. It has a different block of batch database for each analysis invocation, because that's an inherent characteristic of the whole Dupe analysis as it is currently implemented. But it has a separate database that it stores all the information, the gluing, the metadata about the users, who can do what and who owns which analysis, as well as the scavenger information,
so
the symbol information. Yes, currently it's a NoSQL database. There is, conceptually, I have A1, A2, A3, various analyses, either running or completed, whatever, and there is a BDB behind. There's a logic blocks workspace that contains all the data log, all the data encoded and represented in data log. Okay, as we've seen, suppose that we invoke three times, three different invocations of Dupe, and we have a server that can store these invocations as well as the workspaces and the data. And then we have another database that says user cycle owns A1, and also says that scavenge info, source code, symbols, all the Java C plugin magic data that Anastasis gathers of A1 is held here. Okay, somewhere these objects are stored, and then after the post-processing step, the execution of A1, this data that says that at line 32 and column 12 at source file foo.java a new variable is declared, or a new allocation site is met, whatever. Okay, there are some similar metadata about the source file that gets combined with the data log facts, the data log data, and offers the ability to paint the var points to information interactively. There's a direct query running at the time the user clicks on the source code viewer. It's not pre-computed. And if you can still make it, the Dupe client, is it okay with all this? Okay.
So when you click on the screen.
Calls an AJAX call to the
yes.
server.
Yes,
yes, with the coordinates,
okay.
and the line number and the column number, and you see what's there and resolve its relation, if there is any, to draw what you want.
That's one visualization,
yeah,
yeah. to use the geometry of the source code
yeah.
file.
Yeah.
There may be others that we...
But you wrote your own client in the browser to do that. So that...
What do you mean, our own client?
In required, using required JS.
Of course.
Yeah.
Okay. The web UI, as I said somewhere, it's a JS single page application. Using required.js, knockout.js, and various other helper libraries, jQuery, underscore.js, all these things, practically invokes the API to do the magic. And it just renders the result in the way it is, it displays them. I don't know if you want
so its visual representation would be a different module in required.
Yeah, yeah. A different required module with a different knockout template will render a different visualization of. Yet the API is the same. Okay, there is one entry point for querying, one entry point for starting the analysis, one entry point for stopping the analysis, and all these things. I'm not sure you can manage to see some JavaScript code, so I'm going to avoid it, and I'm just going to end up finishing this picture if you. Have the patience for one moment or two. There is a dupe client, practically a dupe client. Let's show the client minus R Centauri, let's call it this way, DI, URG, or whatever, Mion C, the command to execute, list. And this will print out a listing of the analysis that the logged in user has on the server, Centauri. Just another way to consume the API consumed by the web app. And this is a, this client is embedded in dupe-gradle plugin in order to gather all the information from the build script, the jars have been compiled, the JSON files generated by Anastasis through the Java C plugin, and post them to the server. And it also includes the dupe Java C plugin, which both the dupe Java C plugin and the dupe server depend on the dupe persistent package you have, the dupe symbols, let's call it, which are just Java entities, Java classes that designate the model of these concepts. And that's all. If you have any questions, any thanks for your patience and